Welcome to Connie Martinson Talks Books. Tennis, anyone? Well, if your answer is yes, but every time you get on that court, you begin to think, what would John McEnroe do? Wipe it out, because my guest, Al Secunda, has written the book called The Ultimate Tennis, The Pleasure Game, and it's a unique instructional guide for all levels of play. So if you don't want to look like this, which is my guest, Al Secunda, acting like what most of us feel, we will be back after a short pause with Al, author of The Ultimate Game, published by Prentice Hall. Welcome back. We're talking and hopefully playing with Al Secunda, author of Ultimate Tennis, published by Prentice Hall. Welcome, Al.
Hi.
One of, as you are learning, you are laughing, and that's part of your theory.
Laugh and learn, yes. I feel that the body learns best when we're relaxed. And actually, just the word learning to me, growing up, is such a fearful word. For me to learn, I've been trying to learn French for probably 20 years, and just that phrase, learning French, has such painful connotations to it that I feel that we can have fun and learn, and that's what the book's about.
Well, the book also carries these funny, funny pictures, but as you are supposedly learning the word play, I mean, enjoying, as you say, even from the sound, I mean, who doesn't enjoy when you open that can of balls?
The sound, the smell.
The sound, the smell, and you know you are the one who's going to walk off with those three balls, the three new ones.
Right.
But what happens to people when they walk on a tennis court? And I said John McEnroe, because I think people are starting to imitate the fierceness. You know, put your dukes up and let's play tennis.
Mm-hmm. It's a great question. We want to play the best we can, okay? So the question is, how can we play the best?
Okay? Yeah.
We want to win. Now, winning is fine, but if you are going to be struggling for an hour and it's going to feel like your life is on the line, that even winning is fine, but you're going to come off the court and you're going to have such tension in your body that you're not going to feel as great as having a wonderful time for that hour and still winning the trophy. So I'm not saying give up winning. I'm saying, can you lessen the tension in your body? Can you have a wonderful experience? And can you still walk off with the three fresh tennis balls?
Well, the visualization part of see yourself walking off as a winner.
Right.
And then the other thing that you say about getting it over the net and into their court. There was one other sort of codicil I felt belonged there, which is putting it where they're not.
Right. Well, basically, you get on a tennis court and there's so much going on in your mind. Now, I had played tennis for many, many years before I really understood the sport. I got to varsity tennis at college and still didn't know what I was doing. Now, I call that ignorant proficiency.
Yeah.
Okay? So I left the business world and went back to try to figure this sport out. Basically, that's what the book is about. Now, the book is about a little-known fact, which is that the ball has to go over the net first before it can land into the court.
Yeah.
Okay, and most people are so concerned with hitting the ball, or they talk to themselves, I got to get the ball in, they say. I've got to get it. It's not in, it's over and in.
Yeah.
Now, as crazy as that sounds, there's a lot of wisdom, and that's advanced tennis and beginner tennis, that you have an obstacle there called the net, and you have to get it over that.
Now, you give some exercises on arcing the ball, is what I would call it, and hitting it so that you finish through so that it does go over that net.
Right. Basically, hopefully we'll be seeing in a little while a large tennis ball.
Yes.
And it depends where the strings touch the ball. If the strings are going to touch underneath the ball a little bit, you're going to get it over the net with much more clarity and regularity than if it touches on top.
You know, there's a funny picture here of you, Al. I mean, you talk about being both a singer, a performer, and in this book, in some ways, an actor. But I heard the story of a very well-known writer, director, who showed up with the best, well, wearing the Philo clothes,
Fila
clothes, the best new racket, the whole thing. He got on the court and he couldn't hit a ball.
Right, that's called packaging without playing.
Yeah, I mean, never should have gotten on. I should have said, gee, my wrist hurt, can't get on the court. Talk a little bit about mixed doubles.
Okay, mixed doubles probably is the biggest cause of divorce in the country.
Yes.
I don't recommend it unless your relationship is very sound to begin with. Basically, what happens is the men don't let the women play half of the court. They put the women way over in the alley. Now, that's assuming that the woman is not as strong as the man. Of course, if the woman is better than the man, then the woman should basically do what the men are doing now and put the men in the doubles alley.
Yes.
But generally what happens is that the men take on this responsibility of, okay, I'm going to make up for my wife's lack of great tennis, possibly. And what happens is that the man, trying harder than he should, starts deteriorating, and his game falls apart. So he has a game that has fallen apart, and his wife could be playing very, very well, but now he's collapsed. So basically, he gets mad at her because he doesn't want to get mad at himself.
Naturally, and as this happens, we see what is called the collapsible marriage.
Yes, yes.
Speaking of collapsible marriages, Al, we're going to take a short pause. And when we come back, I have enlisted the aid of a tennis maven, a man who has collected the books from A to Z, and who said, as he read this book in bed next to me, I've got to meet that man. I said, you've got to meet that man? You're going on and ask the questions and learn. We will be back after a short pause with Al Secunda, author of Ultimate Tennis, and it's a pleasurable game, published by Prentice Hall, and he will be returning with the mystery tennis player.
The Maven.
Welcome back. We're playing tennis with Al Secunda, author of Ultimate Tennis, and it's called The Pleasure Game, a unique instructional guide for all levels of play. Well, one picture says 1,000 words, one segment of teaching says even more, and I've enlisted the aid of that tennis maven, Leslie Martinson.
Hi. We're going to go over something right now called the volley. Now, the volley means to contact the ball on a fly. If you forget that, just think of volleyball. Okay, the ball does not bounce. Normally, when people are playing the net, they're very tense again. So what is the name of the book? The Pleasure Game. All right, Ultimate Tennis, the Ultimate Volley with Pleasure. That means relax. Keep the body very, very, very loose. And just try to place the strings where the ball is coming, in the path of the ball. So Les will be helping me here. And to do that, we have a little net attached to the tennis racket. In fact, we don't even have strings in there at all. So let's just see what happens. Now, that wasn't hard, was it? Let's try another one. See? His body was relaxed, didn't worry, and what happened? He caught two balls. Now we're going to do the same principle, only we're going to have a net with the strings. Okay? Good luck, Les. All right. See, he's just catching, he's just receiving, and you see how easy that is. There's no backswing, there's not too much of a follow through. He's just using the strings. Now, notice that the harder I throw the ball to him, the faster it can come back. So you can get a very aggressive volley with just placing the strings in the path of the racket. And notice again, he's not tensing. That's great. Now we're going to try with your racket. Okay, just a few that way. Right, again, we want to receive. Make believe like you're receiving the ball. Great, just receive it. Just receive the ball. Right. So you're not giving, you're receiving. Tennis is a receiving experience. Great. Okay.
Thank you, Al. You know, I'd like to go a step further. Being a basket case, until I read your book. Now I call it the Secunda way of going. I've read them all, and now I promised myself, my wife, my mother, no more experimentation. I am going the Secunda way. You've shown me the light. I'm reborn. The basket is thrown away. In Avali, I was truly the worst basket case. So many times in the process of learning, the first thing I was told was turn the shoulder. The racket was way back there. But most important, I noticed that you teach something about the Avali that no one else has ever, what gave me this tremendous amount of light in here. We always see hit from above and hit down, and that it's a down chop stroke. Whereas you, on the contrary, you saw the way that ball came back. You almost talk about the little pinky kind of moving up over the net.
Right.
Is in direct contrast to every one of the 22 books I've read. And I suddenly went out, relaxing left arm and shoulder. Wouldn't ever walk in the court. 5 minutes before driving my car, I now begin
this
relaxing.
This man read the book.
My right.
That's
and
great.
Whoever would think that that volley would not be that hard, stiff chop, and I wait to receive the ball now with a whole different theory of just that, or if I give it any little punch, it's a little linear punch that way, not a down thrust or any of those things that I've always been taught. And particularly, in most every book, the first thing they say is, turn the shoulder. Shoulder turn for the volley, then step in the punch. And you've taken away all the bugaboos.
Well, you made my
I
day.
I wanted to go a step further.
Thank you.
Okay.
Great.
Next.
Next step, we're just going to have a little target practice, and that will be done right over here. Now, basically, very, very few people are aware that they don't have to do too much when they're going for a target. So here's what we're going to do now. Maybe, okay. Maybe you can just stand there, Les.
Okay,
toss me some balls.
Balls.
Great. Okay, now, basically, my goal is to what? My goal is to get the ball to the target, correct? Okay? Now, the shortcut to that is all I have to do is just throw my palm to the target. So if I'm throwing, my palm goes to the target. Well, what's so wrong with doing that in tennis? So the objective is to throw my palm to the target. Now, the feeling is going to be this. My experience is going to be my palm flying to the target. Okay? That's not reality, that's my experience. Even though the ball will be going there, dare I just throw my palm? And I've got very surprised because I just felt this. However, what you saw was the ball going there. Okay? So let's see if I can do that again. You say that's lucky. Maybe it was. Probably was. Here we go. Let's try one more time. Okay, great. So I just experienced my palm flying there, not the ball going there. So that's how we should think of how to guide the ball. You want to try that one more time? Again, the experience is just throwing the palm. So it would feel like this. Okay? So dare I throw my palm to the target. Okay. So basically that is what we're talking about with regard to guiding the forehand. And let's remember what Les was saying with the volley is the same exact thing as what I was doing. The ball follows the path of your hand, forehand, backhand. So with the volley, it's the palm. With the forehand, it's the palm. With the backhand, it might be the pinky knuckle. But think of your palm or your hand flying over the net rather than trying to get the ball over. Getting the ball over is a result, not the action.
Al, let me tell you a couple of things more that in keeping with what you call the linear hit, which is the palm.
Right.
It's really wonderful. In your illustration, you want to take those?
Sure.
In your illustration, you have a little dot here, a little dot there, exactly where that palm should be. Well, to the basket case of those who experiment, and there are a million of us, it's marvelous just to think of that palm being there and that hitting area to there. I also notice in your book there's something that no other tennis book, I've never seen an illustration where you did not complete the swing in that classic hit and they finish up there like that. That your linear swing and the area you call hitting in the linear area ends about right there.
Right. That's a great, great point. Basically, in the book, what I talk about is that you should just be concerned with this experience. If the racket wants to go around, fine. That's the centrifugal force. But I am not trying. Al's job is to create a line. If the racket, if the racket's job is to create a circle, that's fine. But I am not into thinking circles. I'm into lines, even though the racket might be into circles.
Exactly. Which so he goes into the volley, and that little tiny linear hit in the volley, everything is so that, yeah. And also in the backhand, I notice that no one has ever said or illustrated as you do, and you cover it, that your pinky would lead. Now, that pinky knuckle you talk about.
Right.
Well, I stood there then, and I went out on the court, and I dropped the ball, and I threw that pinky knuckle at the ball for where I wanted it to go. And the key word is, let the racket catch up. So instead of struggling and way up here in my nice classic nothing swing that works one time and not again, I simplified the short swing, and I said, yeah, if I'm relaxed here and here, as Al says, that racket will catch up and I will be right in a perfect hit. Am I not?
That's perfect.
And so the key, the illustration of where the dot goes in the forehand, guiding, hitting, as with the pinky, throwing it in the direction and the racket catches up for the hit, it works. And I did go out with just balls in hand, and I just stood and got into the position and just made that little tiny linear hit area up to there. And then the first day I went out, I
won the
competition,
trophy.
Yeah. But I think, again, it's all predicated. The book is so soundly written. There's such thought and wisdom in it. In your first chapter where you talk about the art of relaxation, and without it, there's no basis for beginning. Any process of application, without that sinking in, and you make the point and reiterate it again and again, relaxing that left arm and that the right arm and right shoulder, if you're right-handed. So very important. Just to get out there and do that, you can fall in. You don't have to think that much. Your grip. I've never seen anyone in a book take the eight sides of the racket. And precisely, any beginner can now know exactly what an Eastern forehand grip is.
Well, I always thought it was impossible to learn a grip through a book, and I took the challenge to try to overcome that problem.
In no other book are the eight sides and exactly where nature intended that hand to go, and that part of clarification. And then, of course, your big decision not to show.
Yes.
Not to show.
Because we're talking about, they're all internal pictures. They're not. It's not real. It's not a book about reality. It's a book about what I feel. So every shot is the internal experience of it. And the internal experience for me is a line. Even though at the end the camera will show, Al, you have a nice circular stroke. But I wouldn't know it. I'm so into creating lines. If the racket wants to go somewhere, that's fine. But I do not experience a circle. I experience a line, a pleasurable line, not a tense line.
I'd like to bring up another point.
Sure.
That is so well taken and so important to tennis players. When you go out to play after trying to put new theories in practice, and I have 10,000. As a matter of fact, during the warm-up, I have always been deciding which swing will I use today. Well, that worked a week ago. The point I'm making is, by relaxing the arm and concentrating on relaxation in order of importance, that's the first thing. And the second thing is that you talk about feeling, experiencing the hit. And subconsciously, that's a wonderful, wonderful thing to do, because you know you've hit a ball right when you feel it. And you stress the fact to try and recapture and play for a sense of feel, which ultimately translates into ultimate tennis and ultimate pleasure. And that's why your book is so unusual, because I then went out and began to think of those things. Another most important thing that you stress over and over in the book, only when you eventually go out to play, concentrate on one thing. The mind can't take two. Caesar could do seven, but tennis players can only do one. So when you take the racket back, if that's the thing, get it back comfortably before it bounces. That is the point of concentration to go out and begin. Subconsciously, then, this began to work. But if I didn't get to step one, step two isn't going to work. And you stress that. And very, you know, they say, well, get the racket back. But the basic common denominator of being relaxed and just getting it back before the ball bounces.
And gentlemen, the ball has bounced, and we will be back after a short pause with Al Secunda, author of Ultimate Tennis, published by Prentice Hall. Welcome back. Al Secunda, author of Ultimate Tennis, published by Prentice Hall. Did he wear you out, Al?
I tell you, no one would believe that I just met him, because it seems like we've
tennis
known each
players
other forever.
Under the skin. I should say, in holding up the book, that you really do have the pictures to illustrate spin toss, spin serves, and a part that I wanted to ask about. When you walk on the court and you meet a stranger, and you're going to play that person, what should you look for in their game?
Well, you could look for many things. One is, when you meet a stranger, make believe you have a secret. Just smile a little.
Yeah.
It's a little devilish smile. Just, you know, something that they don't. Whatever it is, where you parked your car, for instance. So you just have, just a little wise smile, right? Now, the first thing to do is to see whether they're a righty or a lefty. Sometimes we get so tense.
Yeah.
We don't even realize that they're a lefty until the second set.
Yeah.
See? So look to see which hand they're holding the racket
mm-hmm.
in. Test to see how their forehand is and how their backhand is, but not just one shot. See how a low forehand is, a medium forehand, a high forehand. By the time the first point begins, you should have a whole checklist of every
mm-hmm.
stroke that they have. And so what you're doing basically is you're spying on them. A warm-up period is not to warm your strokes up.
Yeah.
Warm your body up. Don't worry about your strokes. How's my shoulder feeling, etc. And to know about their stroke.
What about you're now in the set, and you are 5-love?
Mm-hmm.
How do you handle that?
Great question. Many people...
I mean, I found myself at 7-5 losing.
Exactly. Normally what happens is when we're at 5-0, sometimes we're at 5-0 and we've never even beaten this person before.
Yeah.
And we're getting so close. And what happens is, as I mentioned in the book, we go through an identity crisis. We don't know really who we are. If I get the sixth game, I'm not going to have the same relationship with you any longer, is my fear. See?
Mm-hmm.
So our relationship might change. Our friendship might change. I might just get an experience of maybe I'm more of an ultimate player than I ever thought of. And that's pretty scary, changing our identity. So what generally I like to think of is, why have 6 as the magic number? Why don't you make believe there are 12 games in a set?
Yeah.
See? So then 5 to 6 is, because you have to go 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12 to win.
Right,
So it's just the stakes get very high when we think it's the last game where our relationship will never be the same. And fathers and sons go through that. The first time the son beats the father, things are not quite the same in the family the next day.
The other place is you have been in a tennis tournament, you've come up, and suddenly they put you on court one, and there's an audience, and what is this strange object in your hand? It's called a tennis racket.
It's called fear, and fear in my hand, and fear, right. The main concept there is, which is a challenge, and this
mm-hmm.
does not happen overnight, is can I enjoy the experience of being on court number one? Not can I play well. Anytime I go on the tennis court to play well, I do not play well.
Al, apart from Al Secunda, tennis player, you're also a singer?
I'm also a singer, yes, performer.
You talk about breathing and the use of breath in playing tennis.
Correct. There are several ways that you can do that. One is, if you feel a little tense, you're on court one, just as you said, ask yourself, am I breathing?
Yeah.
You might just be looking at that racket, as you said, and thinking it might be a toothbrush or something, you know.
Mm-hmm.
No, it's a racket and I'm really here. You take a few deep breaths, not tension-filled breaths, soothing, nurturing breaths.
Mm-hmm.
Not to punish yourself, but to please your lungs.
Because I've been watching Jimmy Connors play, and lately, or in the last 2 years, it's almost as if he took a yoga course on breathing, where when he serves, he expels breath.
That, on the highest of level, is fantastic, because very few of us are as brilliant as Jimmy Connors. I go in the opposite direction. I say, gently breathe in,
mm-hmm.
because Jimmy Connors is able to channel all his energy, and by breathing out, he is not tensing up. But most of us, when we breathe out, use tension.
Uh-huh.
So what I suggest is people experiment with breathing in, which reminds the body to receive the pleasure. Receive the stroke, receive the ball, receive the vibration, rather than giving. So tennis is not really a giving sport. The ultimate stroke is a receiving sport.
And Al, you have given so much pleasure into the Martinson household with the ultimate tennis. I can only tell you, hours. And it will be probably the most well-worn book next to the Bible in our home. Will you autograph this book for us? And if you would like a copy of our publication, Good Books, write to me, Connie Martinson, P.O. Box 691640, Los Angeles, California, 90069. Please send a stamped, self-addressed envelope. We'll tell you about some other books we've liked recently. Well, Peter Berwesh's Aerobic Workout for Men. As a matter of fact, he's also a friend of Al Secunda's, because one of the dedications is to Peter, who is also a... But this is a book about aerobics, of warming up your body before you walk on the court. And the exercises for men are different than they are, say, in a Jane Fonda workout. Very, very good book. God knows, I have to keep talking about Joe Heller. This is funniest book, and maybe if you need some good relaxation before you play, read God Knows. It is a little bit Mel Brooks, Joe Heller. It is biblical, but it carries through the ages with poetry, Shakespeare, and a lot of sort of New York humor. Very, very funny book. And Irene Selznick-Mayer's A Private View, published by Knopf. This is a book about her life as the daughter of probably the greatest mogul in Hollywood history, Louis B. Mayer. Then she was the wife of David O. Selznick. What was the role of women in Hollywood in those days? So stringent that she then moved to New York to become a play producer. Co-produced with Cheryl Crawford, Tennessee Williams, Streetcar Named Desire, and many of some of the finer plays that were on Broadway. These are her thoughts. This is her book. Very, very good on the history of Hollywood. Ida LeShann's Learning to Say Goodbye, What Happens When a Parent Dies. Again, we've lived through ages where we've hidden, they've gone away, mummy's sleeping. This is a book, Face the Truth. If we know the truth, it sets us free. And in learning, learn a little tennis. Get out there, smell the breeze, feel the ball. Know what it's like to get that clean, good hit. Visit a library, help a child to read, as also help them to learn how to play tennis. We'll see you next week, and don't miss the ultimate tennis, because part of that is the ultimate you. Al, thank you for joining me.
Thank you.
Thank you for
wonderful.
Teaching Leslie. It's been a pleasure.
Thank you.